Our next talk is entitled Global Linear Stability Analysis Past the Solution for Multidimensional EVP and SVD Problems. The authors are Jose Perez and Vasilis Theophilos. The speaker will be Vasilis, who has spent a number of years at the university in Madrid, but has recently, as I understand, accepted a position at the University of Liverpool, starting there. So with that, Vasilis, thank you.
Thank you, Doug. And yes, there are positions opening. If you are interested, we are building a group in Liverpool right now. Most of the work will be drawing upon the PhD of Pedro Paredes, who is still in this audience, Chong Liu and Wei He, who have just got finished and have been supported generously.
Yeah. The microphone.
Okay. And there was generous support over the years by, of all people, Doug, Yvette Pond, and their European office counterparts. Now, I guess you are here to listen to aeronautics, but let's start with culture, since we started with culture. So does anybody know who Lessing was? Maybe some of you do. He was a German writer, critic, philosopher from the Enlightenment time. And you possibly know of his best-known work of Nathan the Wise, the father that inherited three rings to his sons. It's written in the Jerusalem in the Crusades time. So the question is, which of the three rings is the right one? I mean, it was so controversial at his time that it was staged in Berlin after his death. Unfortunately, like 2 centuries later, we are still debating the same issues. Anyway, that's nice. Now, there is an unauthorized biography of Lessing, who sat there, that he was on occasion, he was an avid conference visitor, and he was on occasion commenting in certain conferences that das Neue daran ist nicht gut und das Gute daran ist nicht neu. Translated, the new is about it is not good and the good is not exactly new. So I'll try to convince you. At least he was a critical mind. I'll try to convince the critical minds amongst you that global linear instability is still relatively new. And it's also good for something beyond EVD and SVD. That's how I connect with my title. Okay, definitions. Doug, yes, you are right. This is an operator-based approach, as it was defined by Tim nicely at the beginning. And this probably unfortunate choice of word, maybe we can get rid of it altogether, we just keep speaking of linear stability theory, buries inside it all those blue aspects. Many of you have seen them. I apologize to those that could be bored by the repetition, but there are new faces in the audience, so let me define global linear theory to start with as global modal and non-modal. Now, before I get to that point, let me differentiate between flows with one independent of one spatial direction, so they are dependent in an inhomogeneous manner in two or three, and either of these two could lead to an eigenvalue problem. But in between, we can refine even more and define something called PSE 3D, which is the analog of the classic PSE. Some of you may have heard, some of you may have worked with it, whereby we don't solve an eigenvalue problem, so we shouldn't speak of modes as such, but collectively we will do that. It's actually a marching procedure. And then, just in case you were left with the misconception that global theory is only good for steady flows, we can do time periodic flows too in this way. So the basic state will have this dimensionality, and the perturbations will have the corresponding amplitude functions and then harmonic dependencies, if at all. Here, the only harmonic dependence will be time. Now, I'll spend the next 20 minutes or so showing a few cases out of each of these in a sort of snapshot fashion. And I will be talking about either modal or non-modal. But my starting point will be the equations of motion. You can imagine incompressible Navier-Stokes, the simplest, or hypersonic flow with chemistry and everything, whatever you have it in there. And then, contrary to what Tim showed in his initial slide, I will be assuming a small perturbation superposed to my base state. Remember, this could be either stationary or time periodic. And then I'll be forming the Jacobian, or not. I will just be computing the Jacobian. And then, once I've done that with my system of equations, I'll have a decision to make. Do I follow a modal or a non-modal transient growth path? The difference is easy to write on paper. In one case, we separate space from time. We explicitly introduce harmonic dependence. In the other, we solve the initial value problem. You saw the matrix exponential in Tim's initial presentation, and then we do singular value decompositions. Okay. So remember that. Strictly speaking, we shouldn't be speaking of modal decomposition in both of these cases. Here, we actually speak of sum of modes, but it's in order to do sum of modes, you need to know the modes, right? Okay. And somewhere in the introductory talks, you saw this state space formulation also. And if you follow my dot there, this is the problem that I just defined, which I can extend with other variables. Most important fact is that if I can compute my A, I can compute my transfer function, and then I can do flow control in a theoretically founded way. What I haven't told you yet, it's implicit in everything that I say, is that these Q bars are exact solutions of the equations of motion to the last digit. They are not time averaged. They are not, they are solutions. So if I have solutions and I have eigenmodes, possibly I can do something about them. We'll go into it later. This is one approach to flow control. Another one was introduced in the literature by Hill a long time ago, 92, went unnoticed for a long time, but it basically uses the concept of adjoints. The many words you can read at your leisure later. The point is that if you know, if you can compute the direct problem, you can compute the adjoint, and you can cook the results of direct and adjoint together and identify regions in the flow where you can do something. So this is from the classic example, Strykowski-Srinivasan, almost mirror image theory experiment. The experiment, of course, comes first. Let's take a rod and walk it around in the wake of the cylinder, and let's find out what happens if we leave it somewhere in this region. And there are numbers that you cannot read from the last rows, but basically they are increments in Reynolds number up to something like 70, whereby the wake disappears simply by chance, initially. Now, doing this, it so happens that the so-called sensitivity region, or the region of maximum flow sensitivity, coincides with that where the experiment has told us. So in other words, if we can solve direct and adjoint eigenvalue problems, we might find regions in the flow field where we can do something about and make things happen. And this is from our paper of yesterday, from the modes of the 3D cavity that I'll be discussing in a moment. So no control, something grows. Control, something decays. Okay. As I promised, results will be in a flashing fashion. The only thing that connects them is the Mach number. Let's start low, zero. And let's start with a 3D open cavity, a PET problem. We started working on global stability actually many years ago on that, on the global stability of open cavities. But there and then, we already had to make the assumption that the flow is spanwise homogeneous. Recently, we can do a little bit better than that. And as you know, the motivation is what everybody shows to program managers, and then we run away and make the assumption of spanwise homogeneity and publish the paper, and we are all happy. Okay. I'll try to convince you that we can do a little bit better. So here is the box that Liu did in her PhD. This is a 6-to-2-to-1 cavity. Why did we choose that? Because Liu's group does experiments in that, and we hope to do something relevant to something that has been done before. And this is laminar flow, so we put a Blasius boundary layer there. And these numbers were not immediately obvious. We found out along the way. As I told you, the base flow is an exact solution. So how does one get exact solutions? By DNS, in our case anyway. This is NEC 5000 with selective frequency dumping. This is a technique that permits computing stationary flows that are globally unstable. And then we do the direct tri-global eigenvalue problem. That means a three-dimensional eigenvalue problem. And we use a time-stepping approach. And once we have the results, let's do something about them, or with them. So we did flow topology analysis, which consists basically in reconstructing the critical points of the composite field, what I had initially, plus what theory tells me that will grow. And then look at the results. And one step more, since I can do direct, I can do a joint, and if I can do the sensitivity thing, let's see whether I can control the flow. All in one slide, key findings, okay. In the spectrum, there are modes with different characteristics. I don't show you anything or much of the so-called centrifugal stationary, centrifugal traveling instability. You can find the details in the paper that I mentioned before yesterday, that we presented yesterday. So this is the kind of mode. This is a true three-dimensional mode structure. This corresponds to this guy. This is another mode, which has a different amplification rate. But it turns out that the most important of all is this one. So this is UVW velocity component. And it turns out that when we do the DNS at supercritical Reynolds numbers, we see that the dynamics is dominated by this linear instability. So global linear theory has permitted us identify the critical conditions in a rather non-trivial geometry. I told you about the topological analysis. So this is the base flow, wall stream lines using this mode, that or that, and then just look at the pictures. And thankfully, there was some experiments done at a couple of orders of magnitude higher Reynolds number, and the blue lines are from the original picture, and this is from our reconstruction. We had difficulty convincing the reviewers, but we managed eventually to tell them that, well, what people claimed, that there was a vortex, does appear as pressure minimum here, and this is, of all the downstream developments, the only one that shows this varicose or whatever development downstream. The point is that this is our prediction at 1100, and this is an experiment at a few hundred thousand. And possibly, surely, between here and there, there will be more modes, but this is exact. And this exact mode, exactly this mode, we went through the motions of the direct and adjoint, and then we found some little gadget that we put in the field. It's not always possible. And then we went from a growing in time instability to a decaying instability. Basically, we stabilized the flow. So that was case study one, and sounds great and good. But if you write the things that have not been done, I'm sure you are able of adding quite a few to this long list. Okay, we didn't do, for instance, non-model analysis. I would argue that we don't need to do non-model analysis because if something grows exponentially, it'll dominate in the long run anyway. compressibility can be done. Full stores, full bay models can be done. Give us a big machine, we'll do it. Anyway, I leave that always last as our to-do. Now, this I put specifically for Doug there because he supported this work initially. And the argument, the question there was something called stall cells or separation cells. I mean, stall on airfoils and separation on cylinders. And the work goes back, starts in JFM in 1960 and continues to the present day. And the question is that close to stall, high angles of attack, those structures appear, and the question is, where do they come from? Actually, there are people who have great fun flying gliders and bringing them close to stall and wait for one of those guys, which theoretically is symmetric, to disappear. It can happen, and then, you know. Anyway, our model was, let's take three different, this is actually work in collaboration from an experimental point of view with Miki Amitai's group at RPI. We thought, let's consider different aspects such as thickness and camber, three different airfoils, compute the two-dimensional flows, and then take it from there. This, as you can imagine, implies model by global analysis. We are talking about two-dimensional structures. But this was not enough, we found out. So in this case, yes, we did solve the matrix exponential, and we found out the transient growth behavior, which is basically the SVD of the propagator. That's what this matrix is called. Identify the initial conditions and see what physics tells us. And of course, we did, as a final step, the topological reconstruction. Now, what we knew from earlier work was that there is a stationary mode, three-dimensional mode. What we found in our current work is that a traveling, stationary and traveling different mode, these are two different modes, also exists and actually is more important than the original one. This is damping rate, so this goes higher, so this is more important than this. And actually white and black is two different, totally different methodologies. One is matrix forming with free FEM for the connoisseurs, the other is time stepping with Nectar, different codes, same results. What do these guys look like? Okay, the left one looks like this in terms of UVW amplitude functions. The right one looks like that. So they are clearly different modes. And all of them are exact solutions to the Navier-Stokes, to the linearized Navier-Stokes. Okay? Now, eigenmodes, I said. Maybe you didn't notice that they are damped still at this Reynolds number. So the next question is, what happens when I have only damped eigenmodes? Could their different dynamics appear? And the answer to that can be done through transient growth analysis, which computes the initial conditions, the optimal initial conditions. These are the perturbations, also modes if you wish, that will lead to maximal energy amplification as time progresses. And they don't look at all like the modes, you would agree with me, at the initial time. The fun about it is that as you let time grow, time is a parameter. Okay? I don't think it has been mentioned in this session, at least so far, that modal does asymptotically large time, and non-modal has time as a parameter. So time, the base flow can be time varying. Anyway, so we let this time run. And this is the early time, and this is the late time. And if you are observant enough, you'll see that as time grows, this guy converts itself into something that we've seen before. Namely, it evolves into the KH eigenmode. So the scenario that we initially thought might be related to the stall cells is not exactly so. What happens is that the KH mode, either in a non-modal context or in a modal context, overtakes. So the next question, I mean, this is the original scenario. The composite flow field between the base state and the stationary mode that I showed you, the less important guy. And this is what happens afterwards. Namely, once the KH gets amplified, it will, of course, have the potential to get 3D unstable. This is the Floquet analysis that I showed you in one of my early slides. And there are actually two different modes, and this is the stronger amplified. So if I take this, that analysis tells me now is the most important instability, the most important flow mode, and superpose it analytically to my base flow, look at that. Okay? This is a new mechanism to have stall cells created as a consequence of secondary amplification of the primary amplified KH mode. I may have lost all of you, but please take with you the message that each and every of these steps is an exact solution to the Navier-Stokes. And of course, this scenario can happen at higher Reynolds number 2. Good, lots remains to be done. For instance, higher Reynolds number, multi-element airfoils. Maybe we can do. We can control these modes just as we did with the 3D perturbations, etc. This comes from Pedro's PhD. No, this comes from Wei's PhD. It's a recent question that we posed that started many years ago when I was working at DLR, and we were confronted with the A380 and its trailing vortex system. Now, people could draw as much as a logo, but they were not prepared to accept this or that as an analysis path. Namely, since this is an actually inhomogeneous flow, let's take cuts and let's accept the fact that this flow depends on X. Okay? We did that recently in both approaches, global, spatial global analysis, and PSE 3D. This is the article that we chose. So this is an Epler airfoil. We designed an elliptic cross-section, made a wing out of it, put it in a big machine, and computed the base state. So this is a 3D base state of which we have highlighted only a few planes, plus the fact that there is separation on it. And then we did the classic thing too, just in order to show that inviscid point vortex methods qualitatively show the same thing, but quantitatively no. Anyway, here we employ spatial global analysis to pick up modes, again, and incompressible PSE 3D. I certainly don't have time to introduce these two concepts. This is not mode, but it starts with a mode. Okay? But for the first time, and contrary to our professional interests, we questioned what happens if we do classic, good, old, linear, local stability theory. Do we really need this global monster canon to kill this problem? We were surprised by the results. Anyway, here is the two most important modes. And these, again, are exact solutions to the Navier-Stokes. One is symmetric, about the midplane. The other is anti-symmetric. Compare the symmetric. Let's forget about the anti-symmetric because it's the least amplified. Compare the symmetric perturbation with the Orr-Sommerfeld theory. What does it tell us? Well, that the predictions fall on the same picture. That's already something. We were really surprised by the comparison of a cut through the midplane of this structure, the global mode, with the prediction of the lowly spatial or Sommerfeld equation put on top. You can barely distinguish the differences. Okay? What's the message? The message is that on occasion, if we are allowed to do classic theory, we really don't need to do global theory. They both predict the same physics. Now, the next and final message in this context is that what is better? Let's start the PSE-3D with the data at the initial station, and let's advance them at the next station. Each of these curves corresponds to the different planes that I showed you initially. And as we move downstream in the wake, we basically see that the predictions sit practically on top of each other. You can do either of the two. That's the message here. In this flow, again, lots remains to be done. What I showed you is not good only for incompressible flows, can be extended and has been done for compressible up to hypersonic flows. One highlight has been, okay, you know this motivation, the prediction of instability in the wake of a roughness element at high Mach number. Okay, this is a bit higher than the 2.5 that I showed a moment ago, but this is the motivation. Anyway, here is the DNS done independently in Southampton. There is an isolated roughness element, and something happens downstream. The DNS tells us everything, and let's see what our analysis does. Here we will be using the same spatial and linear spatial bi-global eigenvalue problem and linear PSE, but in compressible context. And here you can see the high, large height and small height, large, small roughness element, and the kind of base flow it generates around it, gray being forward, blue being backward, sort of three-dimensional separation. And as you proceed downstream, you find the base flow evolving into these mushroom structures. And then you do the analysis, and you put lines on top of gray shades, and they sit on top, DNS and PSE-3D, and then you find varicose and sinuous modes. And here you have another mode, which is an exact solution to the compressible Navier-Stokes equations, and predicts the instability in the wake of an isolated roughness element. For that, possibly you could not do local stability analysis. Another advantage that this methodology has, the PSE methodology, unlike the modal analysis, is that it can be nonlinear. And if it can be nonlinear, it can predict transition. And this is a validation study that has been done. More to come in this context. Let's go quickly to the elliptic cone, which has a nice motivation. Artist's view, something that flew up in Norway. Base flow received from right path, planes extracted, analysis done. Symmetric and anti-symmetric instabilities picked up. This will appear hopefully in JFM soon. The exercise of comparing local and global theory again shows surprisingly good agreement given the high degree of inhomogeneity in the base flow. Even more so in the attachment line, what I showed you here is the minor center line axis. What I show you here is the major center line axis, and these are called attachment line instabilities, and they are bang on independently of the local or global eigenvalue problem modes, again. So this is what a pretty mode looks like. This is a Mach mode. You've seen it before, the practitioners. This is a cross-flow mode in a context. I mean, you can feel the pages of high-impact, good journals with pretty pictures. But do we learn new physics is the question, OK? This is certainly old physics reinterpreted in terms of modes. Here we haven't done transient growth analysis yet. Thankfully, HiFire 5 has been flown successfully a couple of weeks ago, so we will be doing non-model analysis for this kind of modes. And to wrap it all up, I just want to make a brief sentence. This is work in progress regarding, again, the same motivation, separation in hypersonic flow, base flow computed by the DLR tau solver, model analysis, standard compressible eigenvalue problem. Barely one can notice differences between perfect and real gas in the base flow, also in the perturbations, but they do exist, and this is the kind of analysis one should be doing. So what is the, this is another mode. What is the message? The message here is that the predictions will be as good as the base flow. We can do the model analysis, but if the base flow is no good, especially in hypersonics, all our work will be in vain. And Anatoly Tumin showed yesterday something called kinetic fluctuations. This is a long line of work that we should be paying attention to before rushing into predicting nice, pretty pictures. Okay? So I'll leave the summary for you to read. Basically, we can do it. The point that I'm trying to make is that we should be useful and relevant. And global modal analysis is one way of doing it. I'll leave it at that. Questions?
Thank you, sir.